When you think of some enormous waves in Hawaii rolling in toward the shore, there's an attractive visual analogy with the way long wavelengths of deep bass behave in any room. But how can we improve or tame those long bass wavelengths? Is it maybe time to think about a second subwoofer? Let's discuss. I'm Elon Osborne, and this is Ecoustically Speaking. Here's a quick exercise. Imagine standing on a cliff above the beach and looking out at the succession of waves. The crests of the waves and the troughs between them represent what happens when a single subwoofer generates the long wavelengths of deep bass, pressure waves that radiate out non-directionally throughout the room. Those waves meet the sides of the room, and depending on the dimensions of the room and where you happen to be sitting, they reflect back and forth, lengthwise and crosswise, creating big peaks of deep bass energy and valleys or nulls of no energy. If your chair or couch unfortunately happens to be located in one of the valleys or troughs of the reflected waves, you're not going to hear much deep bass. But if you get up from your chair and walk a few feet back or to the left or right, chances are you'll hit one of those peaks. We also refer to those as a room's resonant modes, and the bass will be spectacular, although perhaps too much of a good thing. Those peaks and dips in bass energy are called standing waves because the peaks and nulls don't change unless you change the physical dimensions of the room and the frequency of the bass tones. Besides, even if you did alter the room's dimensions, you'd be left with a whole new set of peaks and troughs to deal with. So the problem becomes one of defeating or lessening the intensity of the big peaks and somehow smoothing out the levels of the nulls. In effect, reducing the irregularities and perceived deep bass in multiple locations so that everyone in the room can enjoy deep, powerful, and smooth bass without boom. Unless that boom is intentional, of course, like if you're watching a movie. With some care in placement of a single subwoofer and the listening location, one listener can experience fairly smooth and deep bass in a rectangular room. Unfortunately, other listeners or viewers seated elsewhere in the same room will hear a different bass response, which may have noticeable irregularities. Trying to reduce some of the largest peaks, too much bass at one or two frequencies, is possible with equalization or EQ for one listener and one location. But attempting to use multiple measuring locations and applying EQ simply doesn't work. Adaptation to our own room's idiosyncrasies also helps us to ignore gross irregularities in deep bass heard when we stroll around a room with only one subwoofer operating. Once seated, we tend to tune out or ignore some of those irregularities. Not all, but some. Considerable experimentation over the last decade by leading researchers Dr. Floyd E. Toole, Todd Welty, Sean Olive, Alan Deventer, and others into the behavior of deep bass in rectangular, square, and odd-shaped rooms yields really interesting and practical solutions to the fairly dramatic seat-to-seat variations in bass response experienced in most rooms. The conclusions are fairly straightforward, yet mildly annoying for single subwoofer owners, and apply mainly to rectangular rooms. Using one subwoofer, only one listener can truly enjoy smooth and extended deep bass response in a single seating location. Listeners in other locations will hear different and irregular deep bass. Multiple subwoofers optimally placed in rectangular rooms will greatly reduce the seat-to-seat variations normally experienced using a single subwoofer, resulting in listeners in different seats hearing much smoother and more consistent deep bass. Even numbers of additional subwoofers work best. Two or four subs deliver the greatest benefits in smoothing out irregular bass for multiple listening seats. The really good news, though, according to Todd Welty, an associate of Dr. Toole's, whose paper Subwoofers, Optimum Number, and Locations explored in detail multiple subwoofer performance. Quote, "The conclusion I came to was that two subwoofers give you about 90% of the performance that is possible, and that four take you about as far as you can reasonably expect to go. There seem to be no advantages to using more than four subwoofers in most rectangular rooms. The most effective arrangement of two subwoofers in a rectangular room includes one at the front wall in the middle of the shorter dimension, and one sub at the back of the room in the same relative position. Alternatively, one sub can be placed along each side wall at roughly the middle, with the second sub against the opposite wall in the same relative location. Four subwoofers were found to be most effective when two subs are placed at the middle location of the short wall at front and back. and two subs at the middle location of each sidewall, opposite each other. Placing one subwoofer in each of the room's four corners was found to be similarly effective. The third beneficial arrangement of four subs located two across the front wall and two across the back wall, opposite the two subs at the front wall, of course. One alternative setup that worked extremely well but is crazily impractical for most living setups is what we've dubbed the 25% solution. As Todd Welty told Wes Phillips, an AV columnist for onhometheater.com, you shrink the whole room by 25% and put the subwoofers at the corners of that virtual room. You get incredible performance, but that's just not practical in most rooms. But if you use two or four subwoofers in the wall corners or wall midpoints, you can get pretty good performance. So there you have it, folks. Scientific justification for your spouse as to why you absolutely need a second or third or fourth subwoofer this year. And these days, who doesn't listen to scientists, am I right? And that about wraps up this episode of Ecoustically Speaking. Are you still rocking one subwoofer in your setup? Is it time to save up for a second, or third or fourth? Let us know how many you have in your system in the comments below. As always, to keep up on all things subwoofers, home audio, home theater, hi-fi, wearables, gadgets, and tech, don't forget to bookmark eCoustics.com. Until next time.